In the last video, I described the sequentially consistent model, and I said that this is a model that is intuitive for programmers. Okay, so as a programmer, when you look at your multi-threaded application, there are certain assumptions you make when reasoning about its behavior, and those assumptions include that instructions are executed in program order within each thread, then each instruction executes atomically, right? And this makes it easier for you to reason about behavior because you only have to deal with one instruction's effects at a time. And then the third assumption was that, you know, each thread can make progress at a different rate. So instructions are interleaved in an arbitrary manner. Right? So these are the three assumptions that we made, and we said that, you know, this is what we'll define as the sequential consistency model. And I have to now make sure that the hardware also preserves these conditions, right? So this is what the programmer assumes. Similarly, the hardware should also ensure that these are being preserved. And I'll next show you that if you take the process that we've designed in the past, and if you just make your programs run on those, then by default, you are not going to provide sequentially consistent execution. There's something more that you would have to do at the hardware level to preserve these three conditions. Okay, so let's take the first example over here. So this is the first program that I considered where I was trying to implement mutual exclusion. And we said that, you know, here are two different threads. So as long as you have sequentially consistent execution, it should be impossible for both threads to enter the critical section at the same time. Okay, so, you know, now let's take one of these threads and execute it on an out of order processor, right? We spent many weeks designing an out of order processor. And so I obviously want to use its high performance features. So let me take this thread, run it on that, and let's see what happens. Okay, so take this first thread over here and run it on out of order processor number one. So the first thing it does is it tries to write a 1 into A. Okay, so that's a store instruction. So I'm going to do a store of the value 1 into some memory location whose address is in R1. So let's assume that R1 already has a pointer to memory location A. Then I do various things. Then I have to check the value of B. So I have to first do a load. And let's say that B's address is in R2. So I bring that value and put it into register R2. Then if branch not equal to 0, R2, then, you know, do your critical section. Else, you know, jump to the top. Right, so if R2 is not 0, then jump up over here and try to get into the critical section yet again. Okay, so this is what the code is going to look like. And, you know, as long as there are no unresolved dependencies for R1 and R2, you'll compute these addresses really quickly. And then the load store queue is going to say, well, you know, now what should I issue next? We've said that stores are usually executed when they reach the top of the reorder buffer, right? Because you're modifying the contents of memory. So you have to wait until everything before you has been resolved. And so it is only at commit time that you're going to change the value in that memory location, right? So the store is just going to sit in the reorder buffer for a really long time. And this load in the meantime can be issued early because, you know, your load store queue has this view of this one thread. And it says that there is no dependence between A and B, right? There's no dependence between a write into A and a read of B, right? And so these addresses are completely different. So even though the store has not gone out, it should be perfectly safe for me to read the value of B and proceed. Okay, so the load store queue is going to issue this load as early as it can, right? It need not wait until the store reaches the top of the reorder buffer, finishes, and then if you were to issue the load then you're delaying the load by, you know, many hundreds of cycles. Okay, so in this case, the load store queue says there is no dependence within this one thread, so it should be perfectly safe to issue the load early, and that's what you do, right? So you issue the load, and, you know, what you're going to see is the value of B, which is currently 0. Okay, so this load is going to put a 0 into R2, and this thread is going to say, well, you know, since R2 is 0, I can now enter the critical section. And exactly the same stuff is also going to happen in thread P2. Right, even thread P2 is going to see that, you know, there's a store which has to wait, but the load can issue early, and so it reads the value 0 and then it proceeds. Okay, so for all intents and purposes, you know, these threads are exposing the read of B to the rest of the world before they're exposing this write of A to the rest of the world. Okay, so, you know, neither thread has seen the write of A or the write to B, but in the meantime they have proceeded with reading the values of A and B. Okay, and so, and this is where the problem is coming about. Okay, so the hardware is not meeting the sequential consistency requirements, where you're supposed to finish the first instruction before you can move on to the second. Right? And so previously we said that this is really bad for performance, so I'm going to do reorderings that are safe, and these reorderings were perfectly safe in a single thread context. But when you're executing a multi-threaded program, these reorderings end up being non-safe because they violate the sequential consistency model. Okay, so what we should be saying is that the hardware should no longer be performing these reorderings. It is important for the world to see your store to A first and then your read of B. Okay, and so you know this is pretty bad news from the point of view of performance because we're giving up on our load store queue being able to reorder instructions. Okay, but I'll soon show you how to work around that constraint.